Moving to a second important late breaker, a comparison between ixekizumab IL-17A inhibitor and ustekinumab, a P40 inhibitor. Why is this important? With the arrival of a new class, and I think it's fair to say that the IL-17A inhibitors are there. They're no longer at the horizon, they are theirs. We already have secukinumab in our hands for several months. Ixekizumab in some countries can already be prescribed. In my country, Germany, likely be prescribable from next spring on. The companies all started doing comparison trials to etanercept. Now, etanercept, when it was developed many, many years back, was a fantastic drug. But nowadays, efficacy-wise, compared to the other drug, many would think it's a weak comparator. And also regulatory authorities turn away from etanercept as a useful comparison. So the real comparison today for the new class is, in my eyes, either adalimumab or ustekinumab. So this is why this comparison here between ICSE and ustekinumab was really awaited. We published last year in The Lancet the comparison to etanercept, and there was a big gap between the PASI 75, 90, 100 response with ixekizumab being superior to etanercept. But I think the comparison to ustekinumab, that is what is really waited for. So here it comes. And the study design has two parts. There is an induction phase that goes until week 12, and there's a maintenance phase that goes until week 52. And what was presented here is the induction phase. Now, how was it done? Ixekizumab given at the high dose, the dose that we have in the label, which means 160 milligram at baseline, and then 80 milligram from the next week on, every 2 weeks until week 12, and from then on it will be 80 milligram once per month. But again, I will not talk about this today. Ustekinumab given according to label, so a weight-based dosing of either 45 milligram if you are 100 kilogram or below, or 90 milligram if you are more than 100 kilogram. Shots at baseline, week 4, and then every 12 weeks thereafter. The primary endpoint here was PASI 90, and I think this is interesting. And it makes us realize that really PASI 90 is what is our new treatment goal, is what patients and we want to achieve right now with therapies. Another thing I should say is that the patients enrolled in this trial were patients that would fulfill the label of ustekinumab, Stelara, which is a clear second-line label. So these patients had to have failed conventional therapies, or had to develop side effects, or had to have contraindications against conventional therapies, and only then could they be enrolled in a clinical trial. I'm saying this because the other comparison trial between an IL-17A inhibitor and ustekinumab, secukinumab versus ustekinumab, was actually in patients that could be naive to systemic therapy, and we know that this will have an impact on the clinical response. Now, what was the important outcome at week 12, PASI 90? 74% with ixekizumab, the high dose, compared to 42% with Stelara. Now, that's a 30% gap. And I will come back later to how I would interpret this. Similarly, big difference in PASI 100 responses, where you have 40% at week 12 with ixekizumab compared to just over 14%, so 40 almost with ixe compared to 14 with ustekinumab. Again, going into this 30% difference direction. DLQI, does this mean something for our patients? DLQI 01, again meaning no impact of psoriasis on our daily life. What were the percentages at week 12? There were 63% in the ixekizumab arm compared to 45% in the ustekinumab arm, reflecting and showing to us that this difference in the clinical outcome, the high level of the clinical outcome, PASI 90, does impact the differences in the DLQI outcome in the quality of life of the patients. Now, as a scientist, you should always be able to give a limitation of your study. And I would mention as a limitation here that week 12 is probably not an optimal time point to show what ustekinumab can really do. It was selected because in the pivotal trials for ustekinumab, week 12 was the time of the primary endpoint. It was the time of the primary endpoint in the Ixekizumab trial. So from a formal aspect, that's absolutely okay. But from a clinical aspect, we know that ustekinumab works best at week 22, week 24. So to really understand what these drugs are doing head-to-head, I will wait for, and they will come from this study, I will wait for the longer-term results. What we also learned, just as a little bit of a whipped cream on top of what I just said, how you can push your statistical methods forward. Because what they actually did in this trial is they did not just compare outcomes side by side at week 12 with a Fisher's exact test. They actually did a logistic regression analysis where they took into account factors that we know influence outcome, like duration of therapy, like weight, like geographical region, like baseline disease activity. And not only that, but they also corrected for multiple comparison, because there's a long list today of key secondary endpoints in these clinical trials. And this is interesting, and the p-values for PASI 75, for PASI 90 remain statistically significant in doing so. But it tells me that we are also developing the culture forward, the methodological culture that we will use in looking at these clinical trials.